going to talk about now is about nuclear knowledge management. It's a very new subject, I would say. Most of the people may not be aware of what is nuclear knowledge management, or you may be having some ideas about what is knowledge management, but I hope at the end of this presentation you will understand what are the issues that are concerning the industry for nuclear knowledge management, and what needs to be taken to make sure that nuclear knowledge is preserved, sustained, for safe and sustainable nuclear industry. In IAEA, we have a separate section for nuclear knowledge management because, you know, the industry realized that the issue of knowledge management is quite substantial and quite big, maybe after 2000, maybe 10 years ago or 15 years ago, when people started leaving the industry, or people started retiring from the industry. The first generation of people working for the nuclear power plant started going home, and the knowledge that was associated with them was not available to the next generation of people. So, you know, you just cannot transfer the knowledge overnight, the nuclear knowledge. So the industry started realizing the impact of knowledge management about 10, 15 years ago. And after that, a lot has been done, and many more things need to be done to make sure that nuclear knowledge is preserved and sustained. So we will see in my presentation why and what, why we need nuclear knowledge management, and what is nuclear knowledge management. Some few slides to give new thoughts and provoke your thoughts about knowledge management. And also some, I'm not going very deep into the tools and guidance, briefly some ideas. What are the tools that typically industry uses to preserve the knowledge, or save the knowledge available in the industry? And some consideration and insights for the nuclear knowledge management. And finally, some initiatives, what IAEA is doing on the nuclear knowledge management area. We know nuclear industry uses very complex technology. We must understand this very clearly, that a nuclear technology like a power plant, nuclear power plant, if you look at, can anybody guess how many components are there in a typical nuclear power plant, 1,000 megawatt TWR, for example? Just, if you know any idea, how many components? We have systems, structures, and components in a nuclear power plant, right? How many components do you think is there in a nuclear power plant? Just, you can guess, it's not a, there is no right answer or something, it's only an approximation. It's close to about 100,000 components in a nuclear power station. In a thermal power station or in a similar industry of different nature, different power plant, if you look at it, it's many fold down below that. You do not have so many components. When you have so many components, so many systems, the interactions with this, with those components and systems are going to be more, and going to be more complicated. You look at the control systems or the dynamics of nuclear reactor technology, it's very complex. You look at the today modern nuclear power stations, which are coming with many computer control systems, the INC systems, if you look at it, only the INC architecture of the nuclear island, it's amazing the amount of technology involved. A single person cannot master the entire technology of that total control system. So if that's the case, there's a mechanical engineering, there is civil engineering. If you look at the civil engineering of nuclear power plant, I think, to my knowledge, the only nuclear power plants use a pressure vessel, as a, the civil building as a pressure vessel. I'm not sure whether any other industry uses. The reactor building is used as a pressure vessel. You know, the containment, it's designed to withstand a pressure of, you know, 4 bar or something, typically in an industry. And it involves expertise in civil engineering. And the ordinary civil engineer cannot design such things, cannot maintain such facilities. So we need, we use a lot of complex technologies and need to be maintained for a long period of time, about 100 years, the timeline, long time frame associated with that. It's not going to be just for one generation, at least 3 to 4 generations are going to maintain that. And again, multidisciplinary, it demands several disciplines of engineering. Not only engineering, it needs radiochemistry, it needs radiological protection, it needs nuclear physics, and many, many disciplines of people are going to work in this. And the important thing is unique skills. Nuclear industry needs skills from people which are not normally available in the market. Today, if I lose some 5 control room operators, I want to borrow them from the market, they are not available. If I need to develop a control room operator, it takes about 5 to 10 years. If I need a control room supervisor, it takes more than 10 years. So nuclear skills are not available. We need to make sure that the knowledge that's available with the people are continuously available for the industry throughout its period. Inherent risk, we know about it. Nuclear has its own risk. We need to manage knowledge. If you do not have knowledge, you cannot manage the risk. Knowledge is very important. When you take decisions in nuclear power plants or in any other industry, particularly in an operating nuclear power station, when knowledge-based decisions are taken, they have a consequence. The risk needs to be analyzed. So it's very important that the people work in the nuclear power plant have an updated knowledge about the industry. If you analyze any of the accidents that has happened, like maybe Fukushima or Chernobyl or anything, knowledge played a very key role. People, if only they had a knowledge to manage at that particular time, because when they're working on a transient situation, they're working on a knowledge domain. They don't have a procedure. He's looking at control room panel and then he takes action. He uses his knowledge to make decisions. So the knowledge plays a critical role in such situations. Again, industry has a lot of innovations and improvements, and it keeps growing. The rate at which innovations and improvements are happening in the industry is very fast compared to what was there 10 years ago or 15 years ago. Today, I have a computer within just 3 years, it's getting obsolete. A nuclear power plant uses state-of-the-art technology, so many equipment, so many components, and they get obsolete. And how are you going to maintain them? How are you going to maintain the knowledgeable people who can maintain and operate them? So innovations and things, you need to be equipped for managing such things. The knowledge management comes into picture for all these things. Also, there are many stakeholders. Unlike other industry, nuclear industry has many stakeholders. You have a technical support organization, you have the public and the regulator, you have industry which manufactures, which supplies the spare parts. Too many people involved in the nuclear industry. And everybody's knowledge and the knowledge that they possess plays an important role. If suddenly one supplier vanishes and he doesn't have, you do not have access to buy those particular equipment, you cannot sustain the industry. So too many stakeholders, it puts a pressure on maintaining their knowledge and assets. Competing objects, what I mean is that you have an objective of producing more electricity, at the same time you need to maintain safety. But many times, knowledge plays an important role in deciding which is more important for you, whether it is economics or the safety. A knowledgeable decision is very, very important. And many times, you want to keep the plant operating or you want to shut it down. Yesterday, somebody was quoting an example. If only they decided to shut down the plant, probably we would not have had an accident. So the competing objectives also puts a requirement on nuclear knowledge requirement. This is just showing the different life cycles of a nuclear power plant, starting from the R&D, the design, and then the construction, the commissioning, the operations. Then there is a long-term operation or plant modifications to extend the life. And again, you operate it for another 20, 30 years. And finally, we decommission. This is, we call it the life cycle of a nuclear power plant. And during each phase, when the plant is just started design, there is a lot of knowledge, design knowledge is generated along with that. And again, when you're constructing, there is a lot of knowledge. When you're erecting a steam generator, when you're erecting a nuclear pressure vessel, or the pumps, or the total plant, there is a lot of knowledge involved in this. And this knowledge is important for the operation phase. The operation phase needs this information very much. How are we transferring this knowledge to the operational phase? Is there a mechanism? There is a vendor organization. There are different models in the industry which comes with the design, construction, and operations. How are we ensuring that the construction, commissioning experience, and the design experience is transferred to the operational phase? I can share with you an example. When I was working as a refurbishment manager, we wanted to replace some important components in the primary system, the heat transport system. It's a Candu-type reactor. It's a complicated piping network we were replacing, and you know, it's a huge work. It's about 6 months long period of work, very high intensive work. We just made one feeder pipe. If you, some of you know about the CANDU system, it's called a feeder piping replacement. We replace the feeder, just fabricate the feeder outside and then put it inside the reactor to make sure that the feeders are correctly fitted into the reactor assembly. It's a long precision fabricated piping, simply if I put it. We did it exactly as per drawing. It's not a huge technology. As you know, fabricating a pipe, you know, it's very well known in any industry. Clear drawings, clear dimensions, everything. But then when we went into the reactor, it's not exactly matching. The reactor has got radiation, and you can't work like a new reactor. In a long-term operation, remember that you just have no freedom to work. In a new construction, you can take any decision. Today it's not fine, tomorrow go back and work. In long-term operation, the reactor is already operated, it has the radioactivity, and you need to be very careful in managing your time and other resources. So this was not working. Then we did a brainstorming, and then we couldn't figure out what went wrong. And somebody gave an idea, why not we call that guy who worked there when this plant was constructed. Somebody was knowing his name. He was the guy who fabricated this feeder. He is retired and 70 plus years old, sitting in his house. We sent a car and then got him here. And then he simply, it's a mechanical thing. He just told one tool that we use this type of a tool, fabrication tool, to make sure that the dimensions are correctly maintained. And then we did as per the guidance he told, and then we could manage the entire job done for 6 months. No problem. It's a very simple solution. Came from a very low-level technician who worked in the plant. It's not a design information. It's not a high-level technical knowledge. But then the knowledge which was available with him, a technician, was not transferred in design documents or in any form of documents to the plant, which is not known to us. And fortunately, we had that guy. So what I'm trying to say is the period of 100 years is too much. We are not able to appreciate 3-4 generation of people working. The information which is available here in construction design information is very much needed in the operation phase. So a lot of work is being done in this sense to sensitize people in the nuclear industry that knowledge management means that we need to make sure that what is knowledge needed during the operational phase is available in a right format in the right time. Again, these are some considerations that you can remember about nuclear knowledge because of various cycles in the nuclear industry. For example, economic cycles. There are ups and downs in the economic status of the world. There are many financial up and downs. Some companies get lost in life. Some companies lose. For example, today we say Westinghouse is in problem. What will happen to the reactors which are already manufactured by Westinghouse? So economic cycles affect the knowledge available with some organizations. Again, organizational cycles. Organization itself are under problem. They get disappeared, or they get dissociated, or they get merged with another company. So the knowledge available with them is also getting lost or getting transferred to another area. So there are various things like employee life cycles, employee goes, like facility life cycles and project life cycles as well. So regarding stakeholders, you look at the number of stakeholders. There are more than this. I just typically put the few stakeholders which are there in the nuclear industry. So we need to manage the knowledge available in these many people in an industry. Everybody has a knowledge, and their knowledge is important for the safety of the industry. The public and the media, the member state governments. You can see here the research and development facilities. There are some design and vendor organizations, and fuel and waste management facilities. Educational institutions, they play an important role. They feed the right people to the industry. They are also an important stakeholder for the industry. So in a nuclear power station, operating power station, the KM dimension is going to be fourfold. I'm trying to capture it in this slide to giving how in an operating power plant, how knowledge management plays a key role. So we need to maintain the knowledge and competency of the level of the people. You will agree with me, definitely, because in an operating plan, it's very important. The licensed people who are going to operate the plant, the people who are going to maintain the key components of the plant, their knowledge and competency levels need to be maintained as long as the plant is in operation. So you need to have a program to make sure that their knowledge is sustained. There is also a need to acquire and manage internal and external operating experience knowledge. This is very important in nuclear industry. We learn from each other. There are many things happening around the world. There are incidents and accidents and minor incidents, major incidents, several things happening around the world in industry, and they are all applicable to, maybe applicable to this particular nuclear power station. How are we going to take those knowledge into use for the existing nuclear facility? And there are also many events and incidents happening within the nuclear facility. How are you going to use those operating experience for changing your programs and processes? So that is also another important dimension for the knowledge management in a nuclear industry, in an operating power station. And also, industry, as I told you, is innovating a lot. Industry is developing a lot. Industry doesn't produce a nuclear power station 10 years ago. It doesn't stay the same technology. The technology changes. And how the operating power station is inheriting those knowledge and then making sure that the plant is operated to current industry standards. Standards keep changing. And the industry and the operating power station need to update itself to the requirements of the industry on the current date. So for this, there are vendor organizations and design organizations. Their knowledge need to be continuously available to the nuclear power station. And finally, there are also developing the personnel working in the nuclear power station. They need to develop competence to support the current industry standards. Industry standard is changing, but are the people equipped with the knowledge that is needed to support the current industry standards? So you need to take care of the modifications and the knowledge needed for this plant modifications. Because in a nuclear power station, typically hundreds of plant modifications would be done to make sure that the plant is remaining to current industry standards. So those modifications need to be, the knowledge needed to maintain and operate those modified systems ought to be available to the nuclear power station people. So now I come back to a little bit about the different types of knowledge. I think many of you know the tacit knowledge, the implicit knowledge, and the explicit knowledge. So we categorize knowledge into three types for the purpose of understanding and capturing them. The explicit knowledge is knowledge which is very well easily codifiable, which can be written in the form of a document, a procedure, or a check sheet. Easy to understand, easy to transfer. It's called an explicit knowledge. It's conscious to the knowledge bearer. On the other hand, the tacit knowledge is the most difficult to recall. It is in the subconscious stage. I have a knowledge, and I do the work, but if you ask me to explain that knowledge, I may not be able to tell to you. To give an example, consider myself as an excellent welder. I can do a boiler quality welding to nuclear quality welding. If you ask me to teach you welding, that welding, I cannot do it in one day or one month or 1 year. It may take several years for you to become an expert nuclear quality welder. If I write and give you a beautiful procedure how to do that nuclear welding, it's impossible for anybody to do that. So how are we going to transfer? There are many, many such works and knowledge available in the industry. How those tacit knowledge is transferred? That's the most critical aspect of knowledge management. So this picture tells you the codified and uncodified knowledge and the conscious and unconscious level. As you work from explicit to tacit, you move from conscious to unconscious level of knowledge. Finally, the effective implementation of KM practices. If an organization has a good KM program, knowledge management program, and the benefits that they are going to derive from this knowledge management program is, you identify the business and operational safety risk associated with it. It's most important. Today, people are leaving. It's going to put the company on risk tomorrow. The risk is going to be for tomorrow, not today. Today, people are leaving. The risk is going to be for tomorrow. So knowledge management program helps you to identify in early the risk associated with the knowledge gaps. Again, it adds the value to the existing knowledge, no doubt about it. Existing knowledge can be improved. Converting tacit knowledge into explicit knowledge, knowledge management helps in that. And then improving operational and safety performance through both creating new knowledge and better access to the existing knowledge. This is another important contribution. And then continuous learning at individual, team, and organizational levels. CAIM helps continuous learning in the organization. Also, effective transfer of knowledge to younger generation, one generation to older generation to younger generation. And finally, the improved strategic planning and decision making from access to more and more reliable knowledge. The idea is that CAIM is not a different program in a nuclear organization. There is no separate program called CAIM program or knowledge management program, typically. They are integrated into the management systems. There are several management systems available in the nuclear power station or any industry. So CAIM is basically, if you want to implement knowledge management in a nuclear power station, the best way is to integrate the CAIM elements into the management systems of the or the processes of the nuclear power plant. In a nuclear power station, you would have seen typically these are some of the processes which are followed here, like configuration management or configuration control is a process. Training and qualification is a process. Work control and management is a process. Everything, all these elements have an element of knowledge management. If you look at it, there is knowledge available in this, and the knowledge need to be preserved in all these processes. The idea is not to, totally change these concepts. We don't have to change a configuration control program totally into another system just because we want to implement a knowledge management program. Just identify the CAIM elements associated with those processes and then apply them in the management systems. That's the concept of knowledge management in a power plant. Now I will move on to some tools and guidance which are available for knowledge capture tools, knowledge preservation. One of the important techniques for capturing knowledge is the interview technique. Let's say somebody is leaving, he has a very good knowledge, you need to capture the knowledge available with him. The interview technique is one of the important techniques, but it is not the best method to capture the knowledge available with him, because if somebody has a tacit knowledge, interviewing him and just getting him the answers is not going to be that easy. He will not be open to you. So there are three types of interviews typically followed here: unstructured, semi-structured, and structured interviews. It means that in a structured interview, you already have a set of questions, well-planned questions, what do you want to ask to the expert. Whereas in a unstructured interview, you don't have any preparation. You just go there and then just listen to him and then frame the questions as the answers. In a semi-structured interview, mostly the questions are framed, but then you have an option to add additional questions. Actually, the semi-structured interview works much better in any situation. You need to know what you want to ask him, but at the same time, you need to have some flexibility to ask him additional questions. Generally, interviews are combined with a workshop to form a group of experts, like call the group of experts who have the knowledge and conduct a workshop and then derive the knowledge. That's another idea of collecting the knowledge. Interviews are usually recorded because you can get them back and then understand what really he was trying to say. There is another tool called laddering and concept mapping, because you know most of this tacit knowledge, they are not, as I told you, codified. It's not easy to document, but then it's mapped. It's called the concept mapping. You're asking the guy to make a drawing, process mapping or a concept mapping. These are some of the techniques industry uses to capture the knowledge which is hidden in the minds of the people. This can be combined with an interview technique to model knowledge. Both will complement each other and get the output. Process mapping is similar to concept mapping. It's again like pictures similar to what you have here, because nuclear industry uses a lot of processes for executing works. Process mapping will help to organize what exactly is done here. This is generally done for activities which are non-routine, not routinely done activities. Observation is another important tool. Observing the guy who is performing, that's very important for capturing the information. It's mainly used for like calibration techniques, like specialist welding or equipment setup and operation. And videotaping task performance can be helpful in some in these situations. There are a lot of social interaction tools and knowledge sharing techniques being used here. One of them is the community of practice, which all of you know. It's like bringing the people who have the knowledge under a community of practice, maybe in a computer-based application or similar applications. And the important thing is it needs a management commitment to start. Let's say there are experts in the reactor pressure vessels. You have people in a country, 100 of them, and 10 or 15 people, bringing them as a community together and asking them to share articles in a continuous basis, and then passing on this information to the next generation. This is very well used by many countries, community of practice to promote knowledge sharing. The peer assist is another important thing. Peer is an expert. You know, when there are one expert or more than one expert is available, we normally invite that expert to interact in a group meeting and then ask them to share the information. It's called peer assist. Before start of the project, before starting of the project, the peer assist team meets together, and then it's a process in which an individual or a team arranges a meeting or a workshop in order to make use of the knowledge and experience of other individuals or teams before embarking on a project or activity. From the expert to non-experts, the knowledge transfer. Again, these are some more tools. I will not go so deep into that. Mentoring, shadowing, you know what is mentoring is very, very well known to you. Shadowing is just asking a person to follow an expert. Suppose there is an expert, a trainee is asked to follow an expert and then learn from him. He goes along with him and then works. He doesn't work along with him. He just follows him and then observes how he does the job. That's called shadowing. And again, knowledge marketplaces, like similar to a market. In a market, there are buyers and sellers. In this marketplace, there are people who have knowledge, and there are people who want knowledge. So we make a marketplace, arrange a marketplace concept, so that people come together, and then whoever wants what information gets the information from them. This is another concept. After action review is typically a review of activities at the end of a particular event. This is very well done in nuclear power stations. When important activities are done, they meet together and then try to identify what went wrong, what was done very well, what best can be done in the next time when we do it. So these are captured in a systematic way to transfer the knowledge to the another generation. IT tools. We generally have a belief that IT has a very important role in playing knowledge management. That is true. IT tools are playing a very important role in promoting knowledge management, but IT tools alone cannot do knowledge management. This is a very important point I wanted to emphasize. It's a tool available. The information technology is a tool available, but there should be a system to capture. You should know what you want to capture and how you want to capture and where you want to capture and what for you want to capture. So IT tools are going to facilitate knowledge management, but we need to have a system to make sure that knowledge management system is successful. There are also some KM analysis tools. In IAEA, we do an assist visit to nuclear power stations to help them implement knowledge management program. So the first thing we do is an assessment to understand what's the level of maturity of knowledge management in those nuclear power stations. We have an Excel tool developed by the agency. It asks a set of questions. It's a set of questions, and then the answers are given by the department managers of the nuclear power station. And based on these questions, you can make an assessment of what's the maturity level of this organization with respect to the KM implementation. So this is a very good tool. I can refer, put this material in a reference in the CLP Fernet, you can have access how this KM maturity is assessed in nuclear power stations. And we also have two more good resource material in the IAEA, that is knowledge loss risk assessment. This is basically from US nuclear industry when they realized there is a lot of people are leaving and that's posing business and safety risk to the facility. They invented this tool. It's a tool actually to assess quantitatively how much risk you have in the organization. Very simple tool, but it's a systematic way of organizing. It uses a top-down approach. It comes from the top and then analyzes the various unavailability of human resources or the knowledges. Also, there is another method. It's developed by the IAEA, that bottom-up approach. When there are no people available at the bottom level, how it affects the knowledge loss. So both these approaches are explained in this book on knowledge loss risk assessment. If you have time, if you have interest on knowledge management, I would recommend you to go through these two documents, which we will put it in the CLP Fernet. Some considerations and thoughts for knowledge management. Knowledge management involves people, process, technology. It's very important. It's just not knowledge available only with people. It's knowledge available with people. It's knowledge available with the process. And the knowledge available with the technology. It's a combination of all the three. If you're trying to capture only the knowledge available with the people, it's only one part of it. Because in industry, knowledge is available in all these three areas. And also, you need to consider how the knowledge is generated and validated, and how knowledge is retained and stored, and also how knowledge is transferred and shared, how is it utilized or applied. These are very important for before embarking onto your knowledge management program. Oh. This is a very famous picture we use for explaining knowledge management. You look at, it's a three dimensions. It's showing the three dimensions of knowledge management. In the one axis at the individual level or expert level, the knowledge can be at an individual level, or it could be at an organizational level, or it could be at a national or international level. Also, the knowledge may be available with the people or the process or the technology. And the knowledge is moving. It's starting from R&D. If you look at the facility life cycle, which I explained, from R&D phase to detailed design phase to construction to finally decommissioning and refurbishment, the knowledge is a continuum. It's moving. And you need to preserve the knowledge at each phase to make sure that it's useful for the operational phase. So if you look at all these three dimensions, you can understand the complexity with which the knowledge management of nuclear industry works. KM maturity model. If you look at the KM maturity model, we have it in a three different levels. We say a basic KM, or I would say that it's from moving from a knowledge hoarding culture to knowledge sharing culture, taking an organization from knowledge hoarding culture to knowledge sharing culture. What does it mean? It means organizations, people don't want to have, share the knowledge. That's an initial level. If I have a knowledge, I have value. What for I want to share this knowledge to somebody else? This is typical culture prevailing in the industry. So how are you going to take away from that culture to a knowledge sharing culture? How to move the organization? So that's what it shows, the maturity level of an organization in a KM program. Again, knowledge management approaches. See, industry has seen many changes. This picture is trying to show that how industry has moved. The quality control management, safety management, total quality management, all these are many applications we have seen over the last 2-3 decades. And knowledge management is going to be the next level, is one of the applications. In fact, there is an ISO document going to be issued or published soon on knowledge management. Like you have total quality management or the environmental management systems. Similar to that, there is a knowledge management ISO document going to be used, issued in another year or so. Yeah. Knowledge organization system. This is one area in which we are working now in the IAEA. Is that knowledge is available in the chaos, I would say. The picture was trying to show that it's available in, you know, in different places, in different areas. We don't know how to organize this knowledge. We need to organize this knowledge into in a systematic way, in a structured way, and then transform it to an useful information which can be easily utilized, and then share it with people. And the most important thing is now they are looking at linking those data. The information is available. I will show you in another picture how we are using that linked data, and then finally applied using semantic tools and applications. And this how the knowledge available in the organization is enriched or utilized in a better way. There is a lot of work that is going on in the IAEA. We developed some taxonomies and ontologies to support this facility, this initiative. Means you can look at this picture. This shows that there are several applications available in the IAEA cloud system. PRIS, for example, you know, PRIS safety standards, INIS, any glossary, safety requirement. There are so many standalone applications. Each of them are, you need to access each of them to get the knowledge available there. But how to integrate them? So that's the concept called the linked data using semantic technologies is being applied. It means same type of terminologies are being used for all these applications. Use a common terminologies or common ontologies for understanding the information. So if some information you want to fetch from one of these applications, you can use the same linked data and then fetch it quickly. Finally, a KM implementation process. We are developing a document how a KM can be implemented in a nuclear organization. And it starts with the orientation awareness. We give people to understand what is the importance of knowledge management and its applications. And then the next step is analysis and strategy development. Analysis is similar to what I was showing you. Using the Excel tool, analyze and then find the weaknesses or the gaps in the knowledge management program. And then develop a strategy for implementation. The third step is designing and launching. Designing is very important because implementing a knowledge management program is not going to be a one-day affair. It's going to be time-consuming. You need to sensitize people. You need to implement them in stages. So design and launch a pilot project initially, and then make sure that the results are appreciable or useful for you. Then expand and support it to make it organization-wide. And finally, institutionalize it means make sure that people are owning it. Important considerations for success, because there are certain elements which are very important for successful KM implementation. Organization culture, as I told you, the sharing culture is very important. The culture of the people to share information is very important. So we need to sensitize people and create an atmosphere where people respect the KM programs and they understand the importance of KM for nuclear industry. Ownership of the organization, it should be owned by people. Very important. Without ownership, there is no success in it. IT technology, although it's not going to be the only way to implement, but it's very important for implementing KM programs because there are many IT applications which support the KM program. So a proper IT platform and IT infrastructure is essential for successful implementation. The fourth one is important, standardization of business processes. If you want to implement KM programs, standardization of business processes are very important. What I mean is that typically a nuclear power plant has the business processes are very standard. For example, you do a work management system. Works are done in a nuclear power plant with a clear computer-based application. You can work on a particular equipment only with proper authorization and proper approvals. So this is a system available to implement. Whereas if you go to another industry in an R&D organization, for example, a design organization, you may not have a process to implement. So it's not going to be that easy to implement in an organization where there is no business processes. So what I'm trying to say is it's easy to implement in places like nuclear power plant where there is standard business processes. And another one is the top management support, which is very important. Without that, it cannot be a success. And also, awards and recognition are found to be very useful in industry experience. People expect recognition for the knowledge that they have. So if somebody is coming to share the knowledge, try to recognize and give them some award. So So that is going to be, very helpful in the long way. So finally, some of the IAEA initiatives to support NKM. So we have three types of initiatives to help the industry in knowledge management. The first one is strengthening nuclear education, because nuclear education is very important for the nuclear knowledge sustainability. This school is also one of the initiatives of our KM section to strengthen the nuclear education. We conduct the nuclear knowledge management school, we conduct the nuclear energy management school, and we also conduct several other related schools to support nuclear education in the industry. There are also NKM methodologies. We also develop several methodologies and guidance documents for the industry to learn the tools and methods available for knowledge management. I will show you some of those guides which are available here. And finally, how can we use the information technology, which is evolving significantly in these days, how we can use it as a leverage for implementing knowledge management systems. These are some of the documents that are available for guidance documents available in the IAEA. I'm just put it for your reference. You can see it in your CLP for net reference material. These are the upcoming program publications. We are currently work is going on nuclear knowledge management. We work on decommissioning and environmental remediation. We understand that many of the nuclear facilities, almost yesterday we've seen about 90 plants are going to be taken out of service in near future. And they all need information about decommissioning and the related information. How those decommissioning knowledge can be shared. So a document on decommissioning is going on. The knowledge organization system, which I was telling for BVR systems, the taxonomies are basic requirements. There is a document being developed. And how semantic technologies and their application to nuclear knowledge management can be used. There is another upcoming work on this. These are some more information. The last topic, which is very important and my favorite topic, is about design knowledge. We realize that the design knowledge of a nuclear facility is very important to be transferred to the operating organization, which I was telling in my first beginning also. The design knowledge is not just knowing more, is more than just knowing what the plant is made of. See, for example, if I take a simple example, when Fukushima happened, the people were worried about how to cool the fuel. They were having no water, no electricity, nothing. So the only source of material available to them is only seawater. So they want to cool it. But you know what happened when they wanted to use seawater? The operator need to know, if I put seawater into the reactor pressure vessel, what's going to happen? I need to know what's the material it's made of, how many days I can put, what's the corrosion resistance of that carbon steel for, at that particular condition. So this is a basic information an operator need to know to take a knowledgeable decision to safely take the plant to a particular situation. So it's very important that, I think it's moving on its own. Sorry. So the important thing which I want to touch is the design information to be available to the operator. What industry is doing is a very important thing called plant information model. The new power plants which are being made now, they work on a concept called plant information model, wherein using the IT platform, the design information and the modification information, all such information are available in an IT application. You want to open the design information about a particular component, you can just go to the IT application and find out. If you do a modification, automatically it gets reflected in there. It becomes a living entity starting from the design to the end of its life. The plant information model is a living entity starting from the beginning to the end. So all changes that's happening throughout the life cycle is reflected in a plant information model. which is very easily providing all the design-related information available in a single area to the people. So we do a lot of initiatives in the IAEA to support this model. One is the design knowledge management and also design requirements management. You know, there are several requirements for designing a nuclear power station. And if you want to look at those requirements, you refer hundreds of documents today in a nuclear power station. Some are available in a technical specification, some are available in a maintenance instruction, some are available in some other piece of information. But how do we integrate all this information in one place? That's the concept of this planned information model and getting the information together. I will stop with this. I think the wiki and the other information are other tools available for you know, the knowledge transfer. I'm not going deep into that. We also have a nuclear knowledge management wiki, but the most important wiki the IAEA has is the decommissioning wiki. If you have interest in that, you can get access to this decommissioning wiki in the IAEA platform. Here it's there is a reference given. Here you need to have access to the Connect, and then you have a second step is to apply for an IDN membership. So you have lots of material available in this platform for learning the IDN wiki. And finally, some conclusions. Knowledge management is an essential element of nuclear industry to support safe, economical, and reliable performance. Yes, fine. And important thing is the safety and business objective should be the drivers for KM. So what level of safety we want to achieve? What are our business objectives? Or what are our business goals? That should support the KM program and the KM development. And another thing is the life cycle perspective, which I was telling you, starting from R&D to the decommissioning, the life cycle perspective should be considered for knowledge management. And finally, KM should not be a standalone program in the organization. It should be integrated into the business management so that a KM is sustainable throughout its lifetime. Yeah, with that, I complete my presentation. Maybe if there are any questions, we can answer 5 minutes. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yes. We have a tool to assess the knowledge management in an organization. We typically do a KM assist visit. It's about a 3 to 4 days visit. We bring about 4 to 5 experts in knowledge management, industry experts. They are not available in IAEA. They are available in the industry. Industry people we bring, and then before actually we do the assessment, we seek a lot of information from the utility to understand what exactly they want to improve. Because they're, as I told you, the drivers are important, but the business goals are important. So using those inputs, we design a program, and we use a tool, an Excel-based tool. It has a set of questions, about 100 questions. So it's like yes or no questions, or a qualitative assessment and quantitative assessments need to be made on these questions. And finally, looking at these questions in different areas, we make an evaluation of what is the maturity level of KM in that organization and do a gap analysis. Typically, it's a gap analysis, and we find out what are the weaknesses, and then we give a set of recommendations to them. You can do this for improving to the next level. This is almost about 15, 20 nuclear power stations in and around Europe and Russian Federation have done this KM assist visit program. Yeah, we can also do it for other type of like design organizations. For example, we are done in China for SNERDI. There is a design organization in China. They invited one KM assist visit. It was done last year. It can be done. Yeah, please. Yeah.
Is there any part of the knowledge management plan connected with the public communication with other companies and for example that they are not technical? Is there any part of the knowledge management that can just
You mean to say passing the knowledge, making the public knowledgeable about nuclear? That's what you're trying to say?
Yeah,
Yeah, that's a different initiative. Actually, we have an initiative in IAEA for that, how to make the public knowledgeable about the nuclear things. We target typically the high school students or the higher secondary students, and then provide some training, not exactly training, some awareness information, some practical demonstration of how to use radioactive materials and things like that. But that's called a different name is there. It's not exactly knowledge management. It comes under public outreach activities. We call it a public outreach activities. That's exactly enriching the knowledge of public, which is important for the industry. I agree. Yes, very much. There is a document which is under development, knowledge management for regulatory organizations. Actually, we support many of the newcomer countries which about knowledge management programs. For example, UAE, the Baraka nuclear power station, they had taken a couple of nuclear knowledge management programs to enrich their KM programs. But at what stage typically it needs to be discussed between in the milestone, where exactly you want. But definitely not in the milestone one, the phase one, no. You need to finalize your, make sure that which contract you are going to have, which vendor you are going. You need to finalize your vendor. You're going to start the construction. I think that would be the right time to start this program. Exactly. Yes.
After that, how in this stage, even it's earlier, you have some knowledge, you will also.
What you need before that is not knowledge management. You need a knowledge to make a decision, to make a very, intelligent decision. You know, to what type of plan I need to decide.
I will give you an example. Education and professional
training. What I'm trying to say is that you do not have a knowledge with you. You are a newcomer country. You are going to start a nuclear industry. But without having knowledge, how are you going to manage? You are not going to take the knowledge from outside. Probably you may need some experts who can guide you how to take the knowledge from outside, but not a knowledge management program at this stage. This is what I was thinking. Maybe we can discuss this more leisurely in a coffee break or something.
Why is the knowledge program not part of the India
element? It is why it's not part of the 19 elements of the milestone. But I know, as I told you, KM is actually embedded in every aspect of the nuclear program. It's not a separate standalone program. Yeah, it is part of each and every activity that is being done there. So you cannot just isolate it from as a separate program and do it. Yeah, thank you very much. You have any more questions, please? Somebody was telling. You want it, yeah? In terms of, I didn't get your question very clearly. Okay. No. I think you, the tools which I told you are knowledge capture tools. They are not assessment tools. Assessment is different. Knowledge capture is different. when you want to make an assessment of the knowledge gaps, there is a guidance document available in IAEA which talks about, which gives an Excel tool how to, with a set of questions which I was telling. Using that, you can make an assessment. That's basically a gap analysis, tell you what are the gaps in your knowledge management program. Like interview techniques, shadowing, and concept mapping, these are all some of the techniques which you can use when you know if somebody is having a knowledge. So you know a group of people are having knowledge, you want to capture them. These are tools. Using them, you can capture those knowledge. Okay? Yeah, last question.
Yes, the way I understood nuclear and other industries have a lot of similarities, except just a few exceptions. In most cases, the engineers, the tradesmen, are not going to be trained in the nuclear system. They're going to have gone through other various industries like mineral processing, manufacturing, and all. Then they get into the nuclear system, maybe as a completion of their careers. Is there any tool for nuclearization in the knowledge management platform?
See, this is, I think, interesting question. Not, I think it's slightly away from knowledge management. The people who work in the non-nuclear industry, if they want to come to nuclear industry, we do amount of nuclearization. For example, if you want a technician to come to work in a nuclear industry, he need to be nuclearized. You need to understand the basic concept of nuclear energy and the importance of nuclear energy. So that much level of nuclearization is needed. Apart from that, there are certain skills which are unique to nuclear industry, which are not available outside. That also to be recognized. So both are, both need to be, thank you very much. I think we will close with this. If there are any other questions, we can discuss during coffee breaks or something. Now, this is the time for your group project works. Now, I think all of you have the group project guidance with you, which morning we distributed. What I recommend is the group one. Your mentor is Mr. Yanko Yano. You know him. Yesterday he took the basic principles presentation. He's here. So he's going to be available only for another 2 or 3 days. So you make use of the time available with him and try to understand how to take this project into a logical conclusion. So group one people, please meet with Mr. Yanko and then proceed in maybe one corner of this room or any convenient place for you. And for others, you can discuss among yourselves as groups. Just this is the first day, you know that you are a team. Maybe I just get to introduce ourselves, try to understand what strengths each of you have in those areas. And there are reference materials given to you. Try to capture as much information as possible from those reference materials and try to make a framework for your project before your mentor arrives here. The mentor, the people would be arriving, guides would be arriving from Friday onwards, Friday to Monday. All of them would be available here. Okay? It's a free discussion among yourselves in a group. You can choose a leader among yourselves and then...